screamer is somebody whose defenses and whose alibis somehow melt away, and they actually process what a genocide is without defense, without guile. And when you do that, when you actually like allow it all in, there's no other alternative but to go up to people and to scream and say, you know, the sky is falling, the sky is falling, people are being systematically butchered. We can stop it.
One's here, one's up here, one's up here. They're in between the pods.
Uh-huh.
There they are. They're going to go up.
All right, good. And where's the screen for the intro?
The screen for the intros are off to the sides.
Okay, good.
Serge was asking about a black t-shirt for after the show.
One of those long sleeve shirts. He needs one to change into at the end of the set.
Yeah.
Nice try, man.
Thank you. La la la.
La la la.
La la la la la la la la.
La la la.
There he goes.
There you go.
La la la. But did you see the color of the walls?
I like these colors.
Great, right?
It's a nice room. It should be Shaw's room.
Yes.
We're really excited. We're going to get down and dirty and probably going to show our boobs.
White are like system. They speak their mind. They don't hold fucking back and they run.
It's music with meaning, and I think they express the real truth about what's going on in today's government and today's society.
What do I do? I'm late, right?
Yes, you are. But you can go in your dressing room and, like, you know, chill for a moment. And then I'll come and get you.
System is anti-war, anti-this, anti-that. They're awesome. I love them.
Rock and roll. Yeah.
I'd rather be on a bus and travel than be on a plane.
You don't want a hub in America?
It's a private plane. Which means that when we tour the West Coast, you'll be in your bedroom every night. When we tour the Midwest, you'll be in Chicago every night. When we tour the East Coast, you'll be in whatever city you guys want.
Sometimes I like being like Kalamazoo.
We will have a band bus that you could stay on if you want to. One band
okay,
bus.
Okay, imagine I'm but I do have a point with I like my own bus. That's a cool idea.
People love the realness. This band stands for something. This isn't a, you know, just a someone that's singing about their girlfriend.
Hey, top dollar, because they know. Okay. We're on stage, we're on the motherfucking rage. So Dre, what up?
I'm gonna get the 12 gauge.
Thank you.
by Barbaras with pointed heels. Victorious, victorious, kneel to brand new spanking deals. Marching forward, hypocritic and hypnotic computers. You depend on our protection. Yeah, you feed us lies from the tablecloth.
Everybody's going to the party, have a real good time. Dancing in the desert, blowing up the sunshine. Everybody's going to the party, have a real good time. Dancing in the desert, blowing up the sunshine.
Hey, listen! This band didn't start to change the world. This band didn't start to change your mind. This band just started to make you ask questions.
Letter to a congressman of genocide.
Music is what brings them in, and once they're into the music, the system is a way that they're introduced to different topics, different political issues.
They help us in ways that we couldn't even imagine. They reach out to a community and to an audience that we just would never, ever be able to get to.
Today is the 90th year commemoration of the Armenian Genocide. System of Down have their own obligation as not only as human beings but as Armenians to let people know about who Armenians are.
We don't learn things like that in school. We don't learn things like that. It takes people like System of Down to get the word out, and I think they do a good job of it. Without them, there would be nobody out there that does that.
I'm from a Turkish background. You know what? System is actually, who told me about it? Because it's not in the history books. I think it should be. Like, it should be taught in school. It should be recognized as an actual genocide. I think it's bullshit that it's not. The Turkish government is just denying it. Oh, no, it didn't happen. It's like, they're no better than Hitler.
I'm Jewish, so I tell my children, you know, what happened to the Jews during World War II. Hitler learned this from the Turks. And it's got to be taught in all schools. Otherwise, you have what you have 4 or 5 years ago. More genocide.
90 years is a blink in time. And we can't ever forget, and we can't ever forget, and we can't ever forget, and we can't ever forget.
Listen to this from the New York Times. A considerable population is in danger, ravaged by sickness and privations of every kind, by outrages including murder, refugees robbed of everything they possessed. Does it sound like the ethnic cleansing in Kosovo? Actually, it's from an article 84 years ago about the forgotten genocide. Look at what is happening now to the ethnic Albanians in Kosovo, and you can follow a line that leads finally here to the near annihilation of the Armenians in 1915. It was, quite simply, the first genocide of the 20th century.
My connection comes through my grandparents and the stories that they've told and how they've survived and the atrocious things that have happened in their lives and the way that they describe them is just unbelievable visuals.
As the century began, the Ottoman Empire was collapsing. The Turks, who were Muslims, were being pushed out of the Balkans, where their Christian subjects were in open rebellion. And inside Turkey, 2 million Christian Armenians were demanding better treatment.
It's basically spiritual unrest. And until
until it's recognized, there'll never be rest within our souls, you know. It shouldn't rest. Because a lot of our people died for no reason. You know, they were murdered, and it needs to be brought to the attention of the world.
It is sometimes called the Armenian Holocaust, and one of its perpetrators, Talat Pasha, is known to Armenians as the Turkish Hitler.
Like Hitler's idea of an Aryan society, so that Turkey would be a place only possible for Turkish Muslim people, and the Armenians represented the biggest threat in the Turkish mind to this pan-Turkic ideal.
And in the name of a new Turkish empire, they moved viciously against the Armenians.
Tonight is not just the 90th anniversary of the Armenian genocide. It's also time to break down all the walls of hypocrisy around the world with all genocides, known and unknown, accepted or not accepted. It's time to make the Turkish government pay for their fucking crime!
Pluck!
America's response over 100 years to genocide, starting from the Armenian genocide, what's astounding about the century is that our policy is one of non-involvement and, you know, a desire to maintain neutrality of all kinds, you know, in the face of this kind of carnage and this kind of systematic killing.
I can tell you that today, more people learned about the Armenian genocide through System of a Down than through every other effort combined. They have been able to reach through music, through art, through a very persuasive cultural message that this is an important issue, that the genocide is not an issue about the past, it's an issue about the future.
Turkey run, Turkey hard!
We as a country have not done nearly enough when people are being systematically butchered. The good news is in every single case of genocide in the 20th century, there is somebody, and usually a group of people, who don't block out the atrocities, but actually feel the human beings at stake, and I call them upstanders, you know, not bystanders.
The plan was master God genocide. Took all the children and then we died. The few that
Sartar Abadi, Thank you.
Last time I saw him was before we started the touring, so it's been at least 2.5 months. Ayo. Nigga did it, ayo. A lot of the stuff that's in his life story, it's so amazing. It's so crazy. How man could be cruel to man in that way is kind of really, it's hard for the mind to process.
Urdzenadzes.
He came from Efkere. Efkere is a small town in Gesaria. He lost his brothers and his father.
I was born in Efkere. In 1909, I was born. Haratun was the youngest. I was the oldest. In between the two of us, there was David. It was a big village. There were 500 Armenian houses and 300 Turkish houses.
Happy and normal. They were living with my father and mother and three brothers and sisters. One happy family. 1940, we had our family pictures taken. Everything was fine. Very nice family.
One survivor told me a story. It was nighttime, and she was sitting outside, and she could hear the Turkish woman singing. Couldn't barely make them out in the moonlight. And the Turkish woman was singing something to the effect that poor Armenians, they don't know what's going to happen to them. They're not aware of what's been planned for them.
All of a sudden, 1915 start. Everything started in 1915.
My father, his father, his brother, all the men that were there, they tied them all in chains. We went closer to see him, and immediately a soldier came with a weapon. Away, away, he said. He didn't let us. I mean, I came forward to kiss my father. He didn't let me. He forbade it. And so I went to my father, but I couldn't kiss him. They took him away, and it was the last time I saw him. I wouldn't see him anymore.
They came looking for his father first. His father was hiding because they came looking for him to take him away. Then they found him, and they found all his uncles, and they took all the men in the family away. Then one day they came and told him that they all had to leave. Everyone in his village had to leave.
Those Turks and Kurds, they invaded the house. They took everything out, even the cow's hay. They took it out. Nothing was left in the house.
Let me explain something to you. My dad, his grandfather was shot out of a tree. He was hiding in a tree because they were looking for him. They were looking for the leaders, the intellectuals, the school teachers, everybody first. The Turks saw him, they shot him out of the tree in front of my grandfather. My grandfather saw this happen. Witnessed the death, the execution of his father. Time is forgetful. And if it doesn't directly affect you, if you don't have that grandparent to live through it to tell you, this is bad, this is what happened to me, this was my experience, and have that emotion, to be able to tell you through that emotion. Now, the emotion you're getting from me was instilled by my family. Otherwise,
I don't want to remember. They were taking my uncle and all the guys tied together to the slaughterhouse. I didn't think it was anything serious because I was too young to know. One woman, she was losing her mind because they killed her two sons in front of her. She closed her eyes so she won't see it. They opened it so she can see it.
I feel, I don't know how the rest of the band feels, but it's our duty to bring this up. It was my duty to bring this out outside of this band, and it certainly is to do it while I'm in this band.
Anytime that people utilize economic or religious fervor or nationalism to cleanse their nation of a certain type of minority or a racial group, it's genocide. It doesn't matter whether it happened to the Armenians first in this century, or the biggest numbers were the Jews that passed away in the Holocaust, or Rwanda or Cambodia, or whether Pol Pot did it to his own people, or whether Stalin did it to his own people. Genocide and that kind of cleansing and murder, we should feel that it's one.
System rule!
Yes, system!
We are having our say, we are having our voice on political issues, but they're putting it into music, which is getting out to loads of people across the world. And I think they've given a lot of inspiration to people to be able to have the voice to actually say, look, we want to do something about this.
Well, a lot of people our age are not very understanding about politics, and it's like, stop having a laugh and stuff. I think it's better.
I quite like the new song on the album, Bring Your Own Bomb. I'm quite impressed by that. I'm quite anti-Bush, anti-Blair, generally. So, yeah, I think that's a good message to have, being anti-war. You know, can't really argue with that, to be honest, being anti-war on principle.
The leaflets that people can give to their teachers, and the teachers can send for educational materials on the Armenian genocide. The British government doesn't recognise it. They like to use Incirlik air base, and so if Britain recognises it, Turkey will not let them use that air base.
System of a day!
You shouldn't mess with me. I'll ruin everything you are. And when I get excited, my little China girl, I say, my cock is much bigger than yours. My cock can walk right through the door with the feeling so pure. It's got you screaming back for
Can't you see that I love my cock? Can't you see that you love my cock? Can't you see that we love my cock?
When the regulators that deregulate, when the animators that deanimate, when the propagators of all genocide, burning through the world's resource, here we turn and hide. We're cool, and then
smoking cigaro, cigaro, cigaro. Cool! In an aisle with a crew record, they're smoking cigaro, cigaro, cigaro.
My cock is much bigger than yours.
My cock can walk right through the door. When I'm feeling so pure, it's got you screaming back for more.
Genocide means any acts committed with intent to destroy in whole or in part a national, ethnic, racial or religious group.
We were the last to be deported. Our whole family, my father, mother, four brothers, two sisters. We loaded
on
everything
we
had
nearly 10,000 people. There were now some 300 of us left. My aunt, my sisters and my brothers had all died or disappeared. Only my mother and I were left.
My grandmother was struck down with illness. She died, my grandmother. When others died, the Turks wouldn't allow them to be buried. There was no burying in the ground. So they took her to throw her in the water. On the shore, there were thorns and bushes with roots. Her hair got tangled in the bushes. And whatever we did, we couldn't get her loose. So finally, after the mourning, her body broke off from her head and went on. And her head stayed in the thorns and the bushes. David and I saw that. We freed her head from the thorns and tossed it away into the water.
Then some of the other parents came looking for their children. They mostly found dead bodies. The riverbank there was very sandy. Some of them dug graves with their bare hands, shallow graves, and tried to bury their children in them. Others just pushed them in the river. They pushed them into the Euphrates. Their little bodies floated away.
And they used to take the nice girls for themselves. You should see their father and mother holler, cry. I saw all that. I heard all that.
They raped him, raped our father, right in front of us. And that official made us watch. He whipped us if we turned away.
On the roads, there was no one. On top of those hills, how should I say? Either they were very steep places or very high places. And no one could stand it. No child could walk. How much strength do you have to go down and up those places? Those who fell behind, they would beat them. And if we came to a bad or narrow place, they'd push them, so they'd roll down the hill with the animals towards the wilderness. On seeing this, it puts so much fear into a person. You don't want to look at their faces. They had cut off the women's breasts and so on. Such horrible things. I don't want to talk about that anymore.
My grandfather referred to the murder of a nation, and certainly that's exactly what it was. As the American ambassador, he had many talks with Talat, and the Turkish leader just laughed at him. And Talat said, "It is no use for you to argue. We have already disposed of three-quarters of the Armenians. We have got to finish with them."
The Armenian Genocide is recognized by a number of nations in the world already, and eventually the US and the UK will have to go ahead and do it as well.
We have never, never acknowledged it officially in Parliament. There's always, oh well, it's the word wasn't, genocide wasn't invented. Now that's a pretty fatuous excuse for a British government to use.
Winston Churchill himself described it as the murder of a nation. I mean, the murder of a nation to me is the same as a genocide. Many countries have got national resolutions, particularly countries like France, Germany, Holland, Canada. There is a lot of pressure on America and Britain to do likewise, but they are resisting.
The petition is calling upon the British government to follow the example of 17 other nation states to recognise the Armenian genocide. The betrayal of the British government at the present time to honour our own historical records is actually a very serious issue, and we would like Britain not to betray our history as well as Armenian history.
I think the main reason why the US Congress and the British Parliament and government have held out isn't because they think that terrible massacres amounting to genocide didn't occur. It's more one of not wishing to upset Turkey.
We've got a government that just goes grovelling to the Turks, but why? Why? The Turks said in 1918, when they should have been punished, and remember, it's down on Hansard, you can see that the Turks need punishing for this. Nobody did it, because the Turks said, you need us against the Bolsheviks. A little later on, the West needs us against communism. We want somewhere to mount rockets. The United States can ground rockets under the soft underbelly of the Soviet Union. What does Turkey do now? It's a nice place for a holiday.
The idea that Armenians had been subject to genocide is an historical intrigue, a lie. My father's eyes would fill with tears, and he would say, the Turks were good. Turkish villagers always had good intentions towards Armenians. If they were killed, they must be a grave. Please come and show us the place. We will dig there too.
Denial of a genocide, whether it be the Holocaust or the Armenian genocide, is in fact not only colluding with past genocides, but make it more likely that a genocide will again happen in the future. But we're still trying to persuade our own government that in the face of all this evidence, they themselves should acknowledge the genocide.
Clap your hands. Wake up! You're about to put a little makeup. I just got some. I don't think you trust him. My self-righteous suicide. I cry when angels deserve to die. Self-righteous suicide. I cry when angels deserve to die.
suicide.
I cry
when angels deserve good.
Brilliant, thanks, Serge. Okay, are we okay? Yeah.
You guys published all this?
Yeah.
No way.
The whole purpose of the Institute is education.
Well, I know about the American physician in Turkey, the Usher story from the movie Ararat, and Morgenthau's story I've read. And I think that's really important because, you know, as an American, here's the ambassador of America to Turkey before World War I, and all of the alarms that he was ringing about what the Turkish government was doing and planning as far as deportations and massacres of the Armenians. And he wanted there to be an intervention. He wanted the U.S. to use its influence in ending this before it started. I just, that lower right figure, that little kid looks like my grandfather. Could it be Greece? He was in an orphanage in Greece.
They put us in an orphanage and took us to Cyprus. My brother got left behind. And he died, David, my brother. I went crazy. I was going to try and throw myself into the ocean, and they caught me. And I tried again. Take me to David. And they take me. And now I see there's a cross, and written on it is David Haytayan. Oh, let me get him out. And I start to dig. They said, son, he's dead.
My grandfather's life story of how he survived the genocide has been like putting different pieces of a puzzle together, and I don't know if that puzzle will ever be complete because there's a lot missing. Obviously, we're always looking for the missing pieces.
Ask for a better opportunity. Hand out, look. This is like Jackass. I'm so lucky to be playing music with three of my best friends in the world. Look where I'm at. Well, I live in a coffin. Anyway, but I love it because I do music and play music and that's my life, you know? I don't have to play, because if I had a 9-to-5 job at a bank like I used to, or delivering flowers, I'd still go home at night and play my guitar. You know, I would still be doing this, so I'm lucky. But on top of all of that, to be able to talk about my people and to be able to spread the word about my people and let people know that, yeah, Armenia did exist, and yeah, the Jewish Holocaust might have not occurred if the Armenians didn't, or if people at the time during the Armenian Holocaust raised an eye and looked and said, it's happening, let's help these freaking people that don't deserve what's happening to them. Maybe the Jews wouldn't have had their Holocaust, and maybe Hitler wouldn't have gotten the idea to do it, and maybe other Holocausts wouldn't have happened, you know? Me personally, everyone beyond my grandfather's parents are erased, so I do not have a family tree. My mom's side, they were artists and musicians and architects. When the genocide started, they went for the intellectuals and the politicians and anyone that could have made the genocide harder for them to commit, they took first. My great-granddad saw his mom and his dad get, cut your head off, decapitated right in front of him. And I remember my great-grandpa telling me this story because he saw his mom and his dad go just like that. Who now remembers the Armenians? I do.
Is immune to genocide. Genocides are decided upon by certain political elites. You usually find an enduring crisis of the society, not only in an economic sense, but maybe also in a cultural sense. People will start defining the we group and also the outsiders. And they will think they are our enemies. And then the situation is becoming very dangerous for minorities living in a certain country. Regardless of whether they are a danger, yes or no, they're defined by the perpetrators in terms of their ethnic or and/or religious background or any other form of classification. And that's enough to kill them.
Then their leader said, we were snakes, and they should smash our heads. That was when they started to cut people up. Many of the people were screaming and asking for mercy. You could hear the militia shout, catch him. Here's one of them. Catch him. It was the evening when the killers went home. I went to where my parents had been killed and lay down near my mother's body. We were pretending to be dead. They took stones and smashed the heads of the bodies.
They took little children and smashed their heads together. When they found someone breathing, they pulled them out and finished them off. I saw them kill my papa and my brother, but I didn't see what happened to my mother.
I can't understand it. How could knowing what the extremists were doing in Rwanda, you wouldn't want to stop it? There is a problem imagining these other people who are the victims of genocide. And certainly at the time of the Armenian genocide, it was a faraway place. There wasn't television. There weren't very many people who had been there. Then came those television images of people dying in Sarajevo. Every day, journalists brought it into the living rooms of Americans, and you could see that the people who were being massacred in Bosnia were not odd or remote, but they were women in high heels walking to work, being gunned down by snipers, or children playing in playgrounds. You know, those people that, you know, there's something to talk English, they're like us. And there was a sense that you could imagine who these other people were.
Ouch.
The larger picture was the systematic ethnic cleansing of Bosnia, where terror and killing and mass rape was used to remove the Muslim population, killing some, expelling the rest.
People tend to argue, well, it was a sort of civil war, you know, like the arguments now in Darfur, for instance. It's a civil war, and in war, people die.
I testified against Milosevic for 2 days. He talked about himself as a man of peace. He has only defended Serbia against outside threats. He didn't feel one shred of responsibility for all the people who died in Croatia, in Bosnia, in Kosovo.
Perpetrators. They believe in their myths as if they were true.
The more that you can create the impression that it isn't really genocide, but it more sort of tilts toward war, the easier it is to say, well, bad things happen in war. Well, yes, that's true. War is bad. But genocide is something different. Genocide is about using the cover of an overall conflict to deal with ethnic or religious or national claimants, usually that you've been wanting to get out of the way for some time. So, war for the perpetrator becomes a front.
I think political elites shouldn't get the impression that they can get away with mass killing unpunished.
I'm angry because the ones who have killed my family have come back, and they have their family. They are complete, but I'm on my own. Why should I live with somebody who has killed my family?
I've got nothing to gain, to lose.
All the world I've seen before me passing by.
You don't care about how I feel, I don't feel it anymore. You don't care about how I feel, I don't feel it anymore. You don't care about how I feel, I don't feel it anymore. You don't care about how I feel, I don't feel it anymore.
Whoa.
na na na na na na na na na na na.
Hey, you are me, not so pretty.
All the world I've seen before me passing by.
Silent my voice, I've got no choice.
All the world I've seen before me passing by.
You don't care about how I feel, I don't feel it anymore. You don't care about how I feel, I don't feel it anymore. You don't care about how I feel, I don't feel it anymore. You don't care about how I feel,
I don't feel it anymore.
I don't sleep
anymore.
I don't eat
anymore.
I don't laugh. I don't feel. Passing by, I've got nothing to gain, to lose.
All the world I've seen before me passing by.
You don't care about how I feel, I don't feel it anymore. You don't care about how I feel, I don't feel it anymore. You don't care about how I feel, I don't feel it anymore.
You don't care about how I feel, I don't feel it anymore.
I don't sleep
anymore.
I don't feel the moon.
States often tell themselves one of the advantages of genocide is that you wipe out the problem. Well, no, you don't. There are always survivors. And many of them, having been violated in these ways, will find ways to seek justice.
During the war, the Allies had made a declaration to Turkey saying, what you're doing to the Armenians, you're going to be punished when the war is over. And the war was over, so they took over Constantinople. And they asked the new government to try those who perpetrated this genocide. And the Turkish military court was set up to try these people. Talha moved to Germany because the Germans were allied of Talha. They worked very closely with the Young Turks. The military court system condemned Talha to death in absentia. The government of Turkey requested Talha to be extradited back to Turkey, and the Germans wouldn't give him up.
So here was a guy, you know, Talerian, who was part of a network of people operating initially spontaneously and then later in a relatively organized fashion, who were determined, you know, to take an eye for an eye.
In Berlin in 1921, Solomon Talerian shot Talhat, and his defense basically was, I only executed the guy.
There is no peace in the graveyard.
In Germany, there is a trial, 12 members of the jury, common people, you know, when they hear what happened to the Armenians, in effect, they condemned Talhat. They said Talerian was not guilty.
Raphael Lemkin read about Talerian's trial, and he was struck by the fact that it's the single individual rather than the state that gets apprehended and gets put before a court. And then during the Second World War, while his entire family was being butchered, Raphael Lemkin invented the word genocide to try to get the world to believe that this crime that had happened during the Holocaust wasn't just a one-off. It had happened in 1915, it had happened in the 1940s. And so he decided very self-consciously to try to create a shift in thinking by inventing a word, genocide. And then in turn, of course, inventing a law. So he was a screamer going door to door and saying, we've got to band together and ban this crime.
You know, history seems the longer you go, the more you forget. When it first happens, it's like, how could anyone ever forget? Anybody give a fuck about the Native Americans that were massacred? 25 million Native Americans, approximately, that were massacred in the United States. I mean, hey, we go, ah, that's too bad. And there's some morons out there in Germany that say, oh, you know, the Holocaust never happened. I find that, I mean, it's incredible. It's incredible to say that. I feel very pissed off. Obviously, I'm pissed off that the genocide occurred, but I'm more pissed off at the fact that they call us liars and say that we made all this up. And you know, how could you fucking live with yourself and teach your people, the poor Turkish people that live in ignorance of their past?
I have almost 5,000 of these documents. These are the telegrams of the Talat or the certain authorities in Istanbul, or Bahattin Shakir's telegrams, or the testimonies of the governors or kaymakams, whatever, in the trials, which openly shows that there were telegrams and which gives direct killing order. The main goal was the cleansing of Anatolia of all non-Turkish elements, and this was the non-Muslims and especially the Armenians.
Kabul ediyorlar, kabul etmemizi de istiyorlar. Çünkü soykırım üzerine kurulmuş bir devlet uluslararası hukuka göre devlet sayılmıyor. Onların niyeti hep Türkiye'mizde parçalamak.
Sorosçu istemiyoruz. Üniversitede Sorosçu istemiyoruz.
When I grew up in Turkey, when I was there, people can't even whisper about Armenian genocide. There is nothing, you cannot even find information. So most people are ignorant.
Şimdi San Kartun mesela Aysur. Aysur Gan Türker var, Çen Antunir var, İrenç Babere, Aysur'un Tegaspan'ın tüm radyanız. Hayat yeten Aysur, Pari Marti. Pari Marti. Artık inçü Çen Antunir. At harcımı garevor, inçü çevirin. Vurdu bir renk tegaspanutyan tem getogan serin. Yem kiden vur tegaspanutyunu keşpan mı ne? Yem renk çen gerpek iner. Yem irenz babernal beçe ırat ıllan. Aspesi esenk modetsun mu gırnan.
Once the official in Turkey recognized the Armenian genocide, they know that's not going to stop there. There is a land reparation issue, restoration of personal and real properties that were confiscated during the genocide. So behind all the denialist wall of silence is the fear, because they know that they will stand to lose once they acknowledge the genocide.
We won't go to Turkey and play. That's because, you know, growing up, we've have this built-in thing about us. We have a lot of fans there. We do. I read a lot of letters that come from Turkey. So even though the government doesn't recognize it, we've kind of gotten into the minds of some of their younger generation. And hopefully in time, something will happen because of that. And I'm a patient guy, you know. I don't expect results quick. I never thought, oh, System of a Down's gonna come, we're gonna say things and things are gonna change. Things, you gotta give it time. We have a very, very old culture, like really old. A lot of that history has been forgotten because the genocide holds such a big place in our history now. There's so many Armenian kids that go to public schools and stuff. They don't know how to say Hayrmer, which is just a simple prayer in Armenian. They don't know the Armenian alphabet. I mean, these are things that are special about our culture. We have our own alphabet, like, you know. I think if we let these things live, opposed to killing it off and just talking about the genocide, that's how we fight the genocide, because that's our culture. That's what they tried to erase.
Most Armenian monuments in Turkey have been destroyed.
the state has been active in destroying many of these thousand-year-old churches. And Armenian monuments are being destroyed even today. If you go to Kayseri, the central Armenian church has been left there like a token, but the entire Armenian quarter is not there anymore. They've done everything to erase that past, including the names of villages, even the names of animals have changed. Because the animal name has the name Armenian or Kurd in it. So a deer might be a deer of such and such, deer Armenicus for argument's sake. It shows you the level of fanaticism that permeates Turkish society today. That's ridiculous.
Ve sivil toplum kuruluşları olarak onun filmlerini boykot ediyoruz. Türkiye'de onun filmlerinin izlenmemesi için bir kampanya açmayı düşünüyoruz.
Kendisinin babası işçi olan Arnold Schwarzenegger bu tip bir yalanlamayla neyi düşündüğünü bilmiyorum.
Bunlar yalan ve iftiradır.
Ay Orhan Endiyarisi, şu ya Berçeris, İren At, Haydar Artyan Amar, İren Masina, Nort Atmut Atsvesav, Cişt, Kutyan Antep, Anal, Anarkan Ki.
All Orhan Pamuk said was one reference in an interview. It's not even in his books. He referred to a million Armenians that were killed in his country. That's all in an interview.
Under Turkish treason laws, all you have to do, just maybe write one sentence that the Turkish government can perceive as against Turkish government or humiliating to Turkish government, and you will be arrested and put in jail, if you're lucky.
It is incredible that Orhan Pamuk now faces 3 years in prison for what? For daring to even say that this should be discussed in Turkey today.
There is no dispute that what happened to the Armenian people constitutes genocide.
There is no solid evidence that I've seen in 20-some years that the Ottoman Turks intended to destroy all Armenians.
The fact that every Armenian wasn't slaughtered doesn't mean that that wasn't the intention of the Ottoman Empire. Because the fact that Hitler wasn't able to exterminate every Jew doesn't mean that wasn't his intention and that that wasn't a genocide.
To bring this up year after year after year serves no useful purpose.
Life is a waterfall. We're one in the river and one again after the fall. Swimming through the void, we hear the word. Lose ourselves, but we find it all.
Ignoring genocide begets genocide.
We ought to get on with the problems facing this country and this world today. Terrorism.
Always want to go, but you never want to stay.
If America is not prepared to recognize the murder of 1.5 million people, why should Turkey?
We are the ones that want to choose. Always want to play, but you never want to lose.
Let me hear you motherfuckers scream.
This message out of this committee, if we pass this resolution, it will be heard.
Oh, you free your life, Arios, so up high. When you free your eyes, eternal prize.
Let Come me on, hear everybody. You.
This is not about Turkey. This is about the United States of America.
Call it the genocide jig or the G-word jig, you know? The torturous lengths that governments go to avoid use of the word genocide. politicians devote such energy and such resources to blurring the facts.
Whatever you want to call it, there are clearly crimes against humanity being committed.
Serious humanitarian crisis there.
In the era of that terrible trouble.
I think we've called it a humanitarian crisis.
Leave out genocide for a minute. Genocide just compounds it, makes it even worse.
But I really hesitate to use the G word at this point.
I don't want to step into the gray zone today. I think the secretary will have to give our assessment of the facts and the law and the judgments.
If you're a policymaker and you see yourself as a decent person and a great evil is occurring, you don't like the image of yourself as one who would be allowing something that is preventable.
In all honesty, I can't confirm to you some of the claims that there is indeed a genocidal process going on there.
I, as the spokesperson, am not in a position, given the review of the facts that I have, to qualify or characterize what's going on in Darfur beyond what we have already done publicly in our statement.
This is the Chinese letter.
Dear Ms. Ilhan Essien, I am pleased to join with you and your many friends in Connecticut as they honor you as the oldest living survivor of the Armenian Genocide.
Yeah, he mentions the genocide in there. Now they want him to stand behind what he said.
It would appear that as a policy, the office of the president does not recognize the Armenian genocide as genocide.
Maybe he changed his mind or something. That's the writing like that. I don't know.
Maybe we should ask him.
Because if it's genocide, then you have to do something about it.
So there's a tendency to say, well, you know, we didn't know.
If I, Adolf Hitler, can set the flower of the germination to the hell of war, then surely I have the right to remove millions of an inferior race that breeds like vermin.
After the Holocaust, you can no longer give that alibi that you didn't know. The knowledge was available to policymakers. They could have known and still chose to look away. Toward the end of the century, with the internet and with instant information, you see policymakers saying, okay, knowledge was available, I have to admit that, but we didn't fully appreciate, you know, what it meant.
We did not immediately call these crimes by their rightful name, genocide.
In the case of Rwanda, the Clinton administration had refused to say the word genocide, and there were literally State Department memoranda saying, don't use the word genocide because we'll have to do something about it.
All over the world, there were people like me sitting in offices day after day after day who did not fully appreciate the depth and the speed with which you were being engulfed by this unimaginable terror.
He describes the horrors as unimaginable. So it's a new alibi, it's a new twist on an old theme.
And never again must we be shy in the face of the evidence.
I say in a forthright voice, never again.
Never forget and never again.
I never forget, but because I lost all my families, my mother and four brothers, sister, father, grandmother, grandfather, uncles and aunts and cousins and both side cousins and aunts and uncles. How could I forget? They're all gone. I'm the only one left.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed nay. No. The ayes have it. And the committee stands adjourned. Thank you.
We're over a very difficult, important hurdle. We haven't had a victory in this committee for half a decade. But now we're up against just as difficult opposition in getting it scheduled for the House floor. This committee received last night a letter from the State Department opposing these resolutions. So we're going to have to light a fire around the country to get people calling, faxing, urging a vote on this. There have been bills that have passed the House over the opposition of the House leadership. There aren't many, but there are some. It never happens without a fight, and we're going to have to fight to get this done.
Hello? Hi, how are you? Good. We found out about the House International Relations Committee passing the two resolutions and found out that it's back to Dennis Hastert's hands, the Speaker of the House, to, you know, it's under his power to whether he's going to allow it to go to a full House vote or not. We happen to be in the greater Chicago area, where Dennis Hastert represents the 14th District of Illinois, so we're in his neighborhood, and...
That's my thing.
Yeah, we just decided to ramp up the process.
Hey, way to keep it medium level, Serge.
You can't deny the truth!
You can't deny the truth!
Recognize it now!
Recognize it now!
For coming today. Man.
You guys don't usually try to mix politics and music, but for this issue, it's important.
I think it's much more thrust upon us, you know, the political issues, because we are not afraid to speak our minds. You know, and it just so happens that people gravitate more towards the political aspect of the band. And when it concerns this is for us a personal issue, which we've stated before
I left town. I was talking to my grandfather, and I made a pledge to him. It's personal. It's not a thing, but you know, that I would try to talk to this man here. I don't know if he'll want to see me. Probably not. But if he would, I'd love to bring him some coffee and hang out and talk to him.
That's great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We have some friends here from Los Angeles who I'd like to pass over the megaphone to. We have a letter from Serge to the speaker. Serge, you can read some of the letter to you.
Dear Speaker Hastert, I'm writing to personally ask you to do the right thing by scheduling a free and fair vote on the Armenian Genocide Resolution this year. Historical truth should never be denied in a democracy.
Where are we handing this over to?
This officer here.
Hello. How are you? Good. How are you today? Thanks for taking that. Those as well. Those are petitions. And that's a letter.
Thank you.
The only times that humanitarian issues command the full attention of policymakers is when there is significant domestic political pressure. And if we don't do that, the government will just fall back into its very familiar patterns of only pursuing its economic and its security agendas.
In 1987, I went to Iraq, and Saddam Hussein was in the process of destroying every village in Kurdistan. A year later came the reports of the chemical weapons attack on Halabja, and it just came to me that Saddam Hussein was committing genocide against the Kurds of Iraq, and unless something was done quickly, the population could be wiped out.
I remember what the Holocaust meant to me as I watched the films of the death camps. We gather today to bear witness to the past and learn from its awful example and to make sure that we're not condemned to relive its crimes.
I wrote up a bill that put every sanction I could think of on Iraq, banned the importation of petroleum from Iraq, basically suspend almost all trade with Iraq.
The United States will punish acts of genocide with the force of law and the righteousness of justice.
But the Reagan administration, they thought of Iraq as a potential strategic partner, and frankly, there were economic interests. So when all that was on one side of the ledger, as against taking a stand against genocide of people that nobody had really heard of. The bill ultimately didn't become law. The Reagan administration opposed it. It was defeated or blocked. The Reagan administration opposed sanctions. Interestingly, some of the same people who implemented the war in 2003 were part of that administration and either were silent, like Dick Cheney, or, as in the case of Colin Powell, coordinated the policy of opposing sanctions. It's even sadder than that. In 2003, Colin Powell went to Halabja, scene of the worst chemical weapons attack since the First World War. Frankly, I think he was unaware of his own role 16 years before.
What can I say to you? I cannot tell you that choking mothers died holding their choking babies to their chests.
That he had orchestrated something which put the interest of a strategic partnership with Iraq above the gassing of its own people.
What I can tell you is that what happened here in 1988 is never going to happen again.
We have this double standards, we have this hypocrisy that is completely based on our economic interests. And for example, if we are planning to go to war with Iraq, and if we have decided that Saddam is and Iraq is one of the axes of evils, then we bring up the issues of Saddam and what he did to Kurds in northern Iraq and to Shias in southern Iraq. Bad, bad man against human rights, and we are out there to rescue people and to stand up for the rights. Then you could just go to the other side and say, ah, however, let's as an example, if it's Turkey or some other country doing exactly the same thing for years, continuing it and actually doing it openly, then we say nothing.
Hey, brother, how are you? Oh, we just did the rally. It was really, really successful, really good.
Now it's up to the Speaker of the House, Dennis Hastert, to bring it up to the floor of the House for a vote. He's had the opportunity a number of times in the past to do so and hasn't taken it up for whatever reason, political or otherwise.
There are many U.S. entities and companies that are extremely interested in this genocide resolution, and they are actively preventing that from taking place. I was working in the FBI on hundreds of different investigations, and some of the cases involved certain foreign and U.S. organizations and entities involved in bribing the members of Congress. In certain cases would be small amounts written in checks. In some cases, they were cash delivered inside suitcase. And FBI, the Department of Justice, had in its possession evidence, documented people on tape, proving these activities.
Speaker?
Thank you, Deborah.
Vanity Fair picked one of the biggest and the most visible individuals in this investigation, Dennis Hastert. The Department of Justice was getting ready to publicly and officially investigate certain U.S. officials. But then, under the pressure directly from the Pentagon and the Department of State, they were asked not to go down that road, to cover it up.
This is amazing.
Because Turkey strategically is important. It's a big client, spending a lot of money, you know, getting the weapons from the United States. You need to realize some of the U.S. entities who engage in these types of bribery worked with large military industrial companies, and they had a lot of power. A few years back, many people in Congress wanted to block the sales of Apache helicopters to Turkey. It was amazing how quickly the companies organized their lobbying efforts, and the person they dealt with for this whole entire process was Dennis Hastert. And Mr. Hastert, as he did with the genocide, he took it off the House floor and did not allow the members to vote, and the sales occurred, and again, it was hundreds of millions of dollars.
How are you? I'm fine. That's you. How are you? Good. I'm from the band system over down. From where? From the band system over down.
Oh, yeah, right. Yeah. Great, very good.
You came to your office and gave you a letter.
Oh, excellent.
Yeah. No, did you happen to get it?
Not. I haven't looked at it yet. I've been
on Batavia.
One of those
sure
days. Yeah, right.
Yeah.
I'll look at it. I do that usually in the evening.
Well, we've been here meeting members of Congress and some senators talking about the Armenian Genocide Resolution and the importance to pass it, you know, regarding our history and the Armenian community, and, you know, how important it is to all of us to face a historical reality and help get over this with Turkey. And everyone's been very receptive, and it's been going great. And, you know, we know that it's in your hands, and we
will. I'll take a look at your letter.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
What's happening?
Okay.
Today, Speaker Hastert would be still under the pressure by a military-industrial complex and very powerful entities not to pursue the vote on Armenian genocide. People have to realize that things are happening based on profit, not the real principles.
It's never profitable to save the victims of a genocide. We have to switch priorities from profit to people. And until we do that, genocides will continue, Holocaust will continue, and we will be living that Holocaust as a planet together.
Children by smashing their faces in with the butts of rifles. If they do catch somebody in the village, they usually lock them in their huts to burn them alive.
Everybody was running for their lives. My father followed me and did the same. That is when they cut his head off.
A genocide is being committed in Sudan.
Most of the time when they catch them leaving, it's a male, they'll castrate him.
Genocide has been committed in Darfur.
Something else the Secretary of State said. After he said it was genocide, he said, this determination of genocide requires no further action on the part of the United States government.
At this hour, the world is witnessing terrible suffering and horrible crimes in the Darfur region of Sudan. Crimes my government has concluded are genocide.
The Bush administration seemed to believe that if they called it genocide, that that was doing something. So it was like genocide and then a fizzle. Genocide and nothing happened.
The United States has different interests in Sudan, and the question is which interests are more important than others. So the Bush administration would say one of their stated policy goals is to end genocide in Darfur, and you would think that that would be the top priority.
Approaching, guiding light, our shallow years in fright. Dreams are made winding through my eyes.
Osama bin Laden used to live in Sudan. So the Sudanese government, being very sharp after September 11, 2001, they called up Washington and they said, hey, Osama used to live here. Why don't you send over your intelligence folks and we'll go through the files together. We have a lot of information to share on Al-Qaeda.
The events of September the 11th, 2001 demonstrated the threats of a new era. Last week's decision to raise our national terrorist threat is a stark reminder of the new era we're in. That we're at war and the war goes on.
The Sudanese government is very savvy at how to manipulate the United States. They're able to say, we think there's some Al-Qaeda operatives in the Red Sea Hills, and the United States will send special operations forces to go look for these Al-Qaeda operatives. It's probably just a ruse, but yet here is a country that you've accused their government of genocide, and you're actually collaborating with their intelligence service. In the context of the war on terror, intelligence collaboration is a much higher priority than saving hundreds of thousands, if not millions of lives of people in Darfur, Sudan. Why did genocides continue to occur in the 21st century? Because those committed in the 20th century got away with it. Hitler said, who remembers the Armenians? It's more or less as if the Sudanese government is standing up and saying, who remembers the Armenians?
When we all talk about the genocide, a lot of people refer to the victims as those that perished. And that's definitely valid because a lot of people died. But we don't really pay attention to how much pain the survivors went through. From my own grandfather's experience, I could say that the recognition of the Armenian genocide by the Turkish government before his death, and he's, you know, 96, and so he's not far from that door, would be the first step in redressing an injustice. And I think it would help him go easier, if that makes any sense. At least he would know that the perishing of his family and his whole village is at least recognized by the perpetrators today in his lifetime. I think that would be huge. I do remember him talking about his childhood and living in Efkere. I've thought about going back to go visit my grandfather's village. I think that the land, the rivers, the mountains have a certain pull on us. Wherever your ancestors come from, wherever you come from is a part of your history, part of your story, part of your genetic makeup, your DNA, you know, the land that they worked with and the rivers that they played in. Family living in Efkere and going back and trying to just think of these people being pushed out or killed. It's a very powerful thing. It's a very powerful feeling. Liar! Killer! Demon! Back to the river on us! Someone's blank standing dead! Warfare! Liar! Killer! Demon! Back to the river on us! If I was there, I'd probably feel some sorrow because you would see what happened and the people were forced to leave. You could feel that vibe if you're sensitive to it.
Cases, it doesn't require all that much to take action to stop genocide.
You can achieve a lot with a little in some of these places.
You're either pro-human rights or you're not. You don't pick and choose.
What is unacceptable is to do nothing.
Having to do with revealing truths that are unsaid or unspoken, I think is important. I think we should all be screamers.
Thank you.